Good evening. I'd like to call the December 8th, 2011 Conservation Commission meeting to order. The time is approximately 7:10. As per usual, we'll start our meeting with a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Becky, could you do the roll call for us?
Drew Kinkaver.
Present.
Jeff Bolna.
Present.
Jessica Stacy.
Here.
Stephanie Coster.
Here.
James Bergeron.
Here.
Valerie Shelton.
Here.
And I was contacted by Fred Pearson and Donald Tucker saying they would not be able to make it this evening. So they're excused. And since we have a few members who are not here this evening, I would like to appoint both Stephanie and Jessica as voting members for our meeting this evening. Next up is public comments, and we don't have any public, therefore there's no public comments. And then the next item is the approval of minutes from the November 10th meeting. I believe they were mailed out. I know I received a copy in the mail. Did anyone have any changes, corrections, clarifications related to the minutes?
I wasn't there, but there's a couple of like minor typographical type things.
Sure.
Four lines from the bottom may fall under a, the, I don't know.
Oh,
if that's even important to care about, or if you couldn't hear, right, and that's what it was. But.
Actually, and Valerie, you had submitted quite a few changes, which I don't know if everyone has.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, these are not.
I have copies of those.
Okay.
Does this represent the changes?
I believe that the one that you might be looking at does not represent the changes.
Doesn't have those changes in it yet?
Right.
Yeah, because I got this in the mail, so it's probably.
And that's probably.
I printed this out.
Okay, okay. Oh, so maybe it's already.
Oh.
Do you want me to go through the changes?
Yeah.
Yes, if you don't mind, Becky,
sure.
Please. That would be helpful. Thank you.
Okay, in the paragraph that starts with Adams Colony, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines down, constructed of natural stone with no chemicals, change chemicals to cement.
Yep.
And then in the next sentence, should read, the wall itself will not be in the wetland or drainage easement area, but construction activities and a portion of the wall will be within the 25-foot wetland buffer to hydric B soils, and strike or the easement buffer, however work will be done within the easement buffer. The next line down, starting with Valerie Shelton, read from the wetlands ordinance strike statute regarding special use permits and added, questioned whether the applicant will be able to meet the conditions if there is no area available to provide mitigation elsewhere on the site. If that is the case, the applicant would need to get a variance from the ZBA. She also suggested that this work strike request can fall under a new state statute, and strike question if the Conservation Commission may not have a voice in the matter. And on the last sentence of that page, the strike only, so it should read, the body that grants the special use permit. And one other change on the next paragraph, last line, changing plan board to town planner. And then if you go to page 3, under the Nostrum New Roots Farm, edited to read, to be conducted immediately following the site walk at 32 Huggins Drive. Same change under Smith Audubon. Phil Brown from New Hampshire Audubon is interested in joining the Conservation Commission on their site walk of the property. Change of the spelling of Wadley Falls Road. Next sentence to read, there is 50 feet road frontage for access to the property, but there is no parking area in this location. Parking is at the nearby Audubon site for the, of the former Fox property. And then strike officially road frontage or access property. So I'll say. Under Silverman Schneer, the last sentence should read, the site walk will be postponed until the ground is frozen. And in the last, item number 10, fourth line down, remove their dog's waste and provide their own bags. Was added.
Their own waste.
And the adjournment should be 11, number 11, sorry.
Oh, yep. Did you catch that one, Becky? And then adjournment should be number 11. It's currently listed as 9.
That is everything.
Great. Thank you, Becky. So do we have a motion to approve the minutes as revised?
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? The ayes have it. All right, that takes care of our minutes from November 10th. Treasurer's report?
I would say that the treasurer's reports are most likely on the table upstairs.
I think you feel like that.
I don't think they're having a meeting.
Yeah, the school board meeting is up there.
Okay, never mind.
So I don't know if I can slip in there and grab them.
Let's not worry about it.
Okay.
I mean, well, how about we peek in at the end of the, as far as we know, there's nothing significant one way or the other, right?
As far as I know.
We did have a question the last time about the Obashan expense.
I was going to follow up with Bruce at the meeting tonight, and that was the guess, right? Was that perhaps Bruce?
You're right.
Spent some money. Sometimes he says he doesn't always get his email and it doesn't really work that well for him, so I figured I'd just ask him.
Sure.
Fine.
Sure.
We can't do that.
So we'll check in January. How's that?
That sounds good.
low
activity period.
Yes, exactly. Yes. We'll move on.
So it is possible that, is it possible that there was the money deposited in one of the accounts?
That would be the only thing if any current use came in.
Right.
It's possible, right.
So, but it's this month, next month.
Can I ask a question
about that?
At what point in the process are the land use change taxes supposed to be transferred in the process of development? Because this, in the minutes, you talked last month about the tax for Maya's Way, and they're pretty far along. So I was just curious, that's all.
It's supposed to be assessed at the time the use changes. So typically that would be when the backhoe goes in the ground.
Mm-hmm.
But not all of the land under current use may change at the same time.
Right, okay.
So the land that may be segmented for houses versus the road,
mm-hmm.
those could change when they no longer meet part of the 10-acre requirement.
Okay.
Like when the sale goes through and it's subdivided.
Right, okay.
Or when the house construction starts on. Mm-hmm. That's my understanding of the point in time of when the assessment is supposed to be made, at the time that the land actually changes use. And you can't just go in and say, I'd like to take all my land out of current use,
mm-hmm.
and they'll value it at, say, 100,000. Then you go and you develop it all, and now it's worth 500. Meanwhile, you've only paid a penalty on the 100.
Yep. That makes sense. Okay.
and
so on the second one, like on Mr. Tucker's, that would have been assessed, should have been assessed at the time that he started construction.
Okay.
on the property. And then just that portion comes out, not his whole land.
Right.
He still has enough, it's, you know, 10 acres that's not.
Right.
You know, being used for his development purposes.
And the other thing that I had heard is that you have up to a year, the town has up to a year to assess that land use change taxes.
That's from the time it changes.
From the time.
And if they.
Or from when they know of the change.
Okay.
When they become aware of it.
Okay. And if they don't, if the town hadn't assessed it within that year, do they then?
We lose out.
Okay, thank you.
And that's pretty much the biggest reason we kept saying, what about the current use tax? What about the current use tax?
Yep.
Great. Committee reports? Anything from the town council?
I missed last night's meeting. I was traveling, so I just got back and have nothing for you from the council.
Okay. Anything from the planning board, Val?
Very little on our agenda right now for relative, there's really nothing on the agenda that I'm aware of. I had missed the last two meetings because of conflicts with other meetings, but there is going to be some proposal for landscaping ordinance, and that's going to be presented at Tuesday's meeting. And so I can report that on what that's all about at our next meeting.
Is that for new construction?
I don't know if they're talking about just site plan regulations for commercial development or.
Sounds like it's, you know, it's all about.
The planning board really wasn't involved with it. It's something the town planner's bringing to us.
Great, thank you. That brings us to the chairman's report. We received a letter, and the thing there on our agenda is wetlands permit for the McIntosh well site. We received a copy of a letter that was sent to Administrator Winowski saying that DES has received the information that they require, and that the wetlands permit for the development of the McIntosh well site has been approved. And so we have a copy of that letter.
So that's a 5-year permit? It's a dredge and fill, right? A major impact.
2016, yes, 5-year permit. Yep.
What's the status of that, Jim? I mean, now you have a permit to dig, but you have no authorization from the voters, correct?
That's correct. It's a road, an access road. That's about it right now.
So
pending approval by the voters.
So is it going to be on the ballot next time we vote again? That's a new proposal.
I don't know that. I don't know what the schedule is now that it was defeated. Given our current financial situation, I wouldn't imagine it's going to be moving forward with any great speed, but I don't know.
One thing that was up on the council discussion last night relative to the Conservation Commission is it appears that we'll be getting contacted for a representative to the dam study committee. They're
no pun intended.
Yeah, dam. So I think you should be hearing something on that group.
Okay.
They're trying to get grant money to fund that.
Yes, that's true. That's correct. We started with some seed money, and now they're looking for matching funds, et cetera, to further the study.
Okay, great. Well, when I hear something from the town council, I forward whatever I hear to everyone. But in the interim, you know, people can think about it, and if they have an interest, they can let me know at some point.
I'd say my term's coming soon, to an end soon, so it probably wouldn't be a good idea to put me on it.
However, I'm sure there must be plenty of people with an interest in that commission, but I certainly wouldn't think it would be a good idea to put me in on it.
Okay. Thank you, Jim. And that, yeah, that's really all I had on the chairman's report. So next up is old and new business. Under that, we have the 32 Huckins Drive retaining wall. At our last meeting, Adam Cullinane had come and spoken to us. We did a site walk on the 32 Huckins Drive property the following Sunday, which I believe was November 13th. The owners of 32 Huckins Drive are trying to put in a retaining wall, a natural stone retaining wall, due to the location of wetlands abutting their property. They can't satisfy the requirement of being outside the 25-foot buffer of the wetlands. Basically, the entire wall would be within the 25-foot buffer. And for that matter, a corner of their house is within the 25-foot buffer. So we drafted a letter, which thankfully Val provided some updates on. We sent that letter on to the town planner, saying that based on the ordinance, we don't think it's possible for the homeowner to be able to fulfill the requirements within the ordinance to get a special use permit. So the next step for the landowner is to apply to the ZBA, Zoning Board of Adjustments, for an exception. I don't know what the right phraseology is there.
Yeah, variance.
Exception, variance. So any questions related to that?
So, and that's the extent of the letter. You didn't necessarily, the commission didn't offer an opinion beyond that as to the environmental impacts of the project one way or the other, is that right?
We did put an opinion in there. It's, and I think this is a matter for people listening that affects a lot of landowners in Newmarket who have very small lots. Because when you have any kind of drainage issue or situation on the lot, or just soils that are considered hydric B, I mean, most lawns are in this town because of the clay soil that's, you know, an inch below them. So it's not that they are near high functional wetlands, it's they just are wetlands by definition. And then when you take 25-foot buffers from those areas, if you can't set up a different area on the lot to provide that, you know, twice as much buffer somewhere else, because you only have a quarter of an acre.
For mitigation.
Right. To say, okay, well, I'm not going to touch this, you know, this 10,000 square feet over here when you have a 10,000 square foot lot or 15 or whatever. You know, you can't do that. There's no way to achieve that on small in-town lots. So the opinion from when we were there was relative to more, did we feel there'd be a negative impact on the wetlands that really this man-made drainage swale is also a result of a town culvert that just has not been maintained for how long, we don't know. You barely see the culvert anymore because it's all just silted in. So it seemed to us that as long as they weren't putting pervious, you know, pavement or structures into that buffer, that the fact that you might be taking the slope, building up with the natural stone to kind of level off that area, would actually be a better situation, because now as it exists, you have the paved driveway in the direct slope.
Steep, grassy slope.
So it is grass.
And it's
right
all
down
maintained. Yeah. It's all lawn. It's, you know, and you've got one house here. You've got the driveway, the steep slope, this drainage, and then another steep slope in the other house. So, I mean, I'm not a wetland scientist, but just from a common sense standpoint, if you look at it, you'd think it would be a better situation in less an area that would create maybe a better buffer, because if they're filling, it's going to leave you know, some area to drain down as opposed to sheet feed across.
So I guess to reiterate, the letter that you're sending, is that gonna be included in any way that although they don't meet the standard?
Yes.
We do recommend, not that they move forward, but that it actually is a, what about the actual culvert? Has there been?
We recommended that they talk to the town about that.
Okay, because it sounds like something, just, it's a maintenance issue that should be addressed before it completely closes up and floods the whole area or something.
Yeah, it literally takes most of the drainage from the upper end of Durrell Woods.
Yeah, from.
Wow, so that could actually become quite a situation.
Because this is one of the first phases of Durrell, built down at the low section. And as you kind of, you know, go from this culvert to this drainage area, then there's like a manhole that goes underneath. Right, you can see the other culvert, and there are all these, you know, open manholes that kind of feed into culverts. It has to be going, or coming all the way from the hill.
Could, I mean, it could, if it'd be going in multiple directions, you'd have to look and see how many structures it's actually connected to.
Yes.
But it's definitely taken a lot of water from just that section of the development.
Yeah, it doesn't take a lot of pavement to create a fair amount of runoff.
Yes.
Was any sort of, like a silt fence or any sort of erosion control proposed as part of the project? Because it's, and reading through the stuff you sent us, it looked like it's driveway repairs as well as one, this retaining wall.
No, driveway repairs?
Is it in the like work order?
Yeah, the driveway repair was a separate issue, if you will. I think they just had a section of driveway that was either cracked or whatever. That work's already done.
Oh, okay, okay.
So they're not enlarging their driveway.
Oh, yeah. And that
there's
wasn't
no
the
expansion
and it wasn't
of driveway.
Yeah,
or
none of the driveway.
None of that, right?
And what about for the retaining wall? If they're gonna have some sort of a machine down below, right, to build it, and soil will be exposed and that kind of thing. I mean, it sounds like if it's not a high quality wetland, or even if it's a human made wetland, that's one thing. But you still
we spoke about that, and we kind of thought that it wasn't to the point yet where we would, that's what the way I understood it. So I didn't suggest in the letter, it wasn't the point yet where we'd make suggestions as to how the site would be developed, you know, how the construction would be.
I guess I'm wondering if it goes to the ZBA, will we get a chance to comment on it again if we wanted to for maybe more specific things like that, or?
I don't know, that's a good question. I understand your question.
Yeah.
And I don't know the answer.
Because, I mean, if there are things like, say, erosion control that we're concerned about, I wonder if it would be a good idea to just maybe forward another note along with wherever that was routed, the previous letter was routed, and make sure that gets in the file for it. And the other question
Do we get ZBA notices? Do you get those, Drew?
Not that I know of, no.
That might be worth having Kathy make sure that she, or maybe Sue sends those out.
Sue Jordan.
Put you on the notice list.
Okay.
It's not necessarily a man-made wetland. There's a large wetland.
Right. The area we're talking about being man-made would be what I'm saying is the lawn area.
It's hard to say, really. I'm not, I couldn't say that that's a man-made wetland. I could say that it's currently a wetland and someone mows it and it looks like a lawn. But beyond that, it's hard to say that whether or not, you know.
It was interesting because I didn't see the site, so I would rely on what you guys saw. But when I read the information about the wetland, I saw it sounded to me like it could have been something that was quite nice in the area adjacent to it. I didn't know it was already lawn, you know. But if it weren't, that could have been good habitat for, say, frogs and salamanders that could live in such a wetland that's seasonally flooded, that kind of thing. But based on what you're saying, it doesn't sound like that's the case at all.
No.
I would think the wall would provide an extra habitat.
For like chipmunks.
Salamanders.
Water rock walls are a great habitat for chipmunks.
The base of it.
Man-made wetlands versus natural wetlands, are they held in different
standards? That's that new state law.
So if you make a pond,
you have the right to maintain it.
But is it treated as a wetland? I mean, like a natural wetland would be?
No, they're going to be exempt, or they are exempt. They tried to clarify that.
Even a drainage situation that's occurred that's inadvertently become a wetland, so are we holding it in a different criteria than it really needs to be held in if it's just a damaged swale?
No, our ordinance doesn't. The state law does.
Oh.
And that's for things that are intentionally created, like a pond.
Exactly.
Not something that accidentally happens because somebody wasn't maintaining something.
Or you get, as part of a house development process or a site plan process, you get your wetlands permits, or you get your development permits for where you're going to have your detention ponds or where you're going to have your drainage. And of course, if you're directing it all to that location, it becomes a wetland. And then it all fills in over the years, whether it's vegetation or lack of maintenance or whatever.
Now that's held in the same vein as a natural
feature. Yeah, there's no differentiation, a wetland is a wetland.
Well, it's your mitigation, right? The mitigation we were talking about, so that has to be.
Right, so in the past, you'd have to go through the whole permitting process to like clean them out. And now the state is saying, no, you have the right to maintain these man-made wetlands.
But a mitigation wetland that's created to offset filling a wetland somewhere else is different altogether.
Yeah, okay, yeah, that's.
Yeah, it's very clear in the statute that that is different.
Speaking about mitigation, I have a question as to whether it's possible in town to, in a situation like this, where the lot's really small, there's no place for onsite mitigation. Is there any precedence for people, the developer, say, giving money to the town to engage in mitigation elsewhere?
It's in our ordinance.
It is.
The problem is we don't have the other end of that system set up.
Like a fund or
a
place to use it?
There's no place, there's no fund, there's no identification that, you know, where you would pay in. Yeah, there's, and it's in the ordinance. But there is no, the establishment of how to transfer mitigation off-site has not been established. So that's definitely something to maybe bring up to the planning board or
to the planning board. Is that like what would it take? I don't know. Like it takes what somebody setting up a fund and then writing rules, not necessarily regulations, for how it's gonna.
Well, and also the value of the, you have to determine the value of that wetland that you're converting or
make the ability to actually do something.
Then you have to figure out, well, what's the value of that?
Dollar wise,
but then you have to put into the fund.
I wonder if it's possible, because New Hampshire has their own mitigation fund at this point. I wonder if they would ever share, you know, their valuation system with the town.
So let's say that this hypothetical fund existed, and this person at Huckins Drive wants to put their wall in. We determine that mitigation has to help them. They need to go into the system and pay towards mitigation elsewhere.
Right, to pay to have a buffer elsewhere.
So that could be
elsewhere.
Across
like
town and a different area entirely.
Which is, I think, what Jessica's referring to, because when you do these major highway projects.
Yeah.
That's what happens.
That's what's
how
happening.
How do you, it's apples and oranges, okay, what's.
Right.
Well, so he's doing something that's a little bit harmful to his property.
Right.
Not beneficial like it is right now. How do you quantify that to the project over there?
Well, it's not quantified to the project over there. It's quantified to what's the value associated with what you have impacted.
So you put a dollar amount on that?
Right, and how are you going to offset that?
Oh.
And you can't do it on your own property, so you take the money of whatever that impact is worth, and then that gets paid into the fund.
To purchase land or create conservation easement.
Or create buffer somewhere.
It's not just for restore,
that's
another.
Yeah.
Actually, buffer on somewhere that's being developed, so it would be worth.
It's kind of like a carbon credit.
Create a buffer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a good point, though. I guess it would be the DOT evaluation. Is that where that would fall under?
Or. So New Hampshire has, they call it the ARM fund.
What is ARM?
And I can't remember what it stands for. I think the last thing is mitigation.
Okay.
But it's a big thing that they just got off the ground, and the contact for that, I think, is Lori Summers at DES.
Personally, I don't like things like that. To me, that's difficult, because that can create class issues where if you don't have the money to buy your way out of the mitigation, you can't do it. So, it's just my perspective on things like that. They sound good, and they can have a positive impact in the long run, but they definitely take people that can't afford to pay the penalty and count them out of the possibilities that other people have access to.
That's true, but that's true with many aspects of laws and regulations in general, right? If you, just to develop a property, you need to be able to hire a consultant for this, that, and the other thing, and that's going to knock a lot of people out of being able to do that as well.
Yeah, but that's different.
Now you also give somebody a process to do some harm, but they just have to buy their way out of it.
Right.
Well, there's the alternative, I guess.
Right, that's, it's like
speed. Don't worry.
I hear both sides.
I can speed.
A few more elections, there will be no more laws.
Yeah, exactly. I hear what you're saying.
But just to summarize and to clarify, we aren't suggesting that the current owners of 3200
Drive. No, this is all hypothetical.
Right, this is all hypothetical.
But I do have one more question about that specifically. I was wondering, so Durrell was permitted as a subdivision or multiple subdivisions along the way, and I wondered if in the original permitting process, the planning board may have put any restrictions on what could happen in the wetland buffers going forward.
They weren't. Quite certain there would have been no buffers at the time.
It was 1987.
But there's an easement, there's a drainage easement through there. Yeah. So legally they can't put anything in the easement.
Right.
Any
okay.
kind of a structure.
Okay.
Right. And that lot looks like, I don't think there were regulations at the time. I don't know for sure. I saw the plan today. From 1987.
The regulations would have been different at the time. We probably didn't have buffers.
Right.
Yeah, because it appears, if you look at the lot, that fill was added, and the wetland flags actually kind of go to the base of fill that was put in to build the house, and the wetland flags come right up to that, the existing retaining wall that's there, stone wall that's there.
And that would be consistent with state statute.
Yeah.
There's no buffers
right.
to state wetlands.
Yeah, definitely.
Thank
you. Thanks.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
I'm just wondering, you're kind of taking notes as action items, and I'm trying to find out, is that an action item then? I mean, are we going to try to encourage this process to be started, or the fun thing, or is that not really something that we are going to tackle right now?
It's on, when we did the water resources chapter update for the master plan, that is include, you know, we've done the shoreline update, but then it all changed, so we're probably going to want to revisit that. And then we've done, you know, with all the work with stormwater management, that was, you know, part of the water resource chapter action plan. And I would think that the, you know, when the planning board's going to deal with the wetlands ordinance, or if the conservation commission wants to send a request to the planning board to revisit the wetlands ordinance, then I think that would be an action item.
Revisit it.
But it really has to start, it starts at the planning board.
Could we draft a letter asking them to consider such a...
To revisit the wetlands ordinance?
Yeah. For that purpose.
For that purpose, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You'll probably bring it up on new business too, just from this session.
I know.
Same on shoreline. If we want the planning board to revisit shoreline ordinance. Do that
under
new business.
Sure.
Or we can talk about it now.
Let's do it under new business. Okay. So I don't know if you got an answer out of that, Stephanie.
It sounded like we were talking about drafting a letter to encourage the planning board to revisit the wetland ordinance in regard to potentially mitigation fund allocation.
I think you'd look at the whole thing.
Okay.
Yeah. Just
and they would
basically,
just do that.
You know. Should there be an update to the wetlands ordinance?
Okay. All right, next up is stewardship monitoring. And we continue to be pretty active and busy there. On November 13th, we went out and did the Nostrum New Roots Farm. Valerie, Jeff, and I, and Donald were on that, right? It was a nice visit. We didn't see any, we walked a fair amount of the boundaries. The ones we didn't walk, we could visually sight. We didn't see any easement violations. Everything seemed to be in order, seemed pretty good. Our one difficulty is there's a wetland area that is on the plan, marked out, and no activities are supposed to happen within that area. One of the carcinite markers we were not able to find. Somewhere along the line, it's been knocked down, removed, who knows what. But there wasn't anything, based on where we thought it should be, we didn't see any easement. There was nothing going on in that wetland buffer area.
It's good. Eagle Eye? Thanks, come on.
Any additional comments?
I finished the monitoring report with, thanks, Jeff sent over the photos. I wanted to make sure Stephanie had something to check off, what next to my name. And I sent it out to the three other attendees. If you guys can just review it when you get a minute. Let me know if there's any modifications or corrections. I can't remember if I put that one marker in there. I did put in about painting the other markers. Yeah. Now we still need to do the posting. But if as soon as I hear back from the three, I will then get that copy sent off to the parties that need copies, and then we can file the original report here.
Great. Thank you.
I would suggest one thing, is that before we paint those, or if that's what we decided we're going to do, that we just contact the folks at the farm and see how they feel about brightening those up quite a bit out in the field. They haven't been in violation so far. On their you can kind of see them. I mean, granted, they are a little difficult to see at times, but I can just see them saying, they kind of blend in right now. We respect them. We know they're there.
That's a good idea.
We don't necessarily want to
they
see
them. They do a wonderful job with that property. They really do. As far as really using it for agricultural purposes and relative to the purpose of the easement. They've been doing continued work on invasive removals. And, there was the only slight real question or issue was just the ATV use of the trail, that little wetland area.
Right.
And that's that's not those owners. That's,
right.
That's somebody coming
right.
along a power line that, mm-hmm. that goes along the border.
Are we going to have that one post replaced?
That marker?
The missing.
Yeah, I think those would be the two action items.
Yeah.
And then the three would be if we're going to paint.
Yeah.
So the action items, Stephanie, are replacing a easement marker and posting the, I'm not going to say posting, the marking the public easement boundary.
Oh, the far outside where?
That still has never been done.
Between
the non-easement area and the public easement, which is really the backside of the Tuttle Swamp easement or corridor.
In terms of these action items, are these things that were resolved before?
The only thing we can't do probably is replace that one marker.
No, we'd have to hire like a Doucette surveyor, someone like that.
Evidence of its old location?
No. One thing that we could request be done is, there's only one that's gone missing, is that something metal's put in the ground next to it. In case it's gone somewhat again, you can metal detect and find it, and then just put it back in the same place. Oh, sorry. I don't project very well.
So Jeff was just saying, if we're going to replace the marker, we should have a metal pole put in as well to make it easier to find with a metal detector.
Something that's like flush with the ground that wouldn't stick up and, you know.
Okay, so maybe we should take action on that, to just have authorization to have Doucette do that.
That one at Loyzel that we had Doucette do, they used something with a cap. Didn't they like a post that was flush with the ground? Remember that? Those worked out pretty well.
Pin.
Like a rebar with a cap.
Rebar with a cap.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, this would be the same thing, but not putting a, I mean, not putting a cap on it. Just putting it next to, like driving in the ground and with the Carr's Knight marker in next to it. We did this on another project, actually, where in case somebody came along and stole it, then we can just go back and find it quick and then just drive a new one in.
Brush hog mows over it.
Yeah, then you just go back and pound another one in.
So that we could take action on.
We could.
Shall we?
We don't hold your list against you, by the way.
You mean, have somebody task make a motion?
Yeah, let's have a motion to authorize hiring Doucette to reset that. How do you spell that?
D-O-U-C-E-T? Carr's Knight, C-A-R-S-O, I think it's C-A-R-S-O-N-I-T-E. That's a guess.
To reset the Carr's Knight marker along with a metal pin.
Yeah, pin in the ground.
A second thing. If that was your motion.
That was the motion.
That was the motion.
Seeing that that was an expenditure motion.
We don't have a dollar figure associated with that, should we?
Not to exceed.
Or whatever it costs. Yeah, let's not have a dollar.
I don't remember the cost of the posts themselves.
Would it be over $500?
No.
No.
Definitely not.
Would you like
to set? To locate it and?
To locate it, but it is definitely not that much money.
Would you say not to exceed 500?
Sure.
Which, yeah. Say not to exceed 250, 500 is fair.
$250's good.
Well, I hope they don't get anywhere near it.
At what point do the things, where we're hiring people have to go out to bid versus we just hire them?
Over a certain dollar amount.
Is that what it is?
And then also,
In something like this?
Like $5,000.
If a surveyor has already done the job.
Done it all.
Okay, that makes sense, yeah.
They already have all the data and all the information.
Just curious.
They are the most efficient.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, and I would say, if like we're going into like redo something, it was going to be like a $20,000 project, I would definitely say put it back out to bid and see.
Yeah, no, it wasn't about.
But if, yeah.
So repair.
That's particular, just in general.
Yeah, in general, it's much cheaper than the original surveyor.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion, we have a second for that motion. Any further discussion on the motion?
Did we add the $500 as a definite?
Yes.
Okay, just curious.
Not to exceed.
Not to exceed.
Okay, I'm not hearing any further discussion on the motion.
The only thought would be, that would be to come out of the larger fund.
Mm-hmm. We only have one fund.
One fund.
Right, it wouldn't come out of, well, we have multiple sources of money, but we only have one fund. We have the smaller town budgeted money.
Of our management fund.
That would come out of our
maintenance, I guess.
Maintenance.
Sure.
The Conservation Commission fund.
Sure.
Call it what you will.
Our new treasurer's on top of his hand.
Indeed.
Just so I can write it down, so I can add it to that.
You got a little treasurer's hat for
for my phantom reports.
It's been done many a time.
All right, then I'd like to call to vote. All those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, next property related to stewardship monitoring was the Smith Audubon property, Smith Sisters Audubon property. That one was done on Sunday, November 20th. Thankfully, we had a nice day. Phil Brown from New Hampshire Audubon came out with us, and Stephanie, it was you and I and Phil, right? Just the three of us. We walked the majority of the boundary and put up little boundary easement signs that, you know, are Audubon easement signs. We did see there were a few violations. There was one spot where a number of trees had been blown down on an abutter's property and some on the property that has the easement on it. And the abutter cut up trees that were on their property and then climbed over the stone wall and cut some additional trees that were on the, you know, on the easement. So we're going to need to send a letter to that abutter to say, hey, you've cut some trees over here, cease and desist.
Could you tell if the trees had fallen or were they, you know what I mean? Had they fallen across the wall onto his abutter's property?
So some definitely had not. There were some trees that were downed in a wind event and had been cut up, which, you know, first of all, there shouldn't be any cutting on the other side of, on the easement side of the wall.
Right.
So some were downed in a wind event and had been cut up, and then others were cut down and laying on the ground.
They were still there.
Yeah.
You mean, oh, cut, so not cut for firewood or something, just cut
just
down.
Cut. Yeah.
Mm. Pretty fresh.
I mean, in between last year's easement monitoring this year's.
Yeah, that's true.
yeah, and I mean, you know, and it, the encroachment was 15 feet, 20 feet. Oh, actually, it was probably more than that.
Yeah.
At least in one area.
Wow.
Like, yeah.
Cut them down so I don't follow my land anymore, or
for sunlight maybe.
Yeah, what type of trees?
Well, I wasn't. There was still shade, but there were potentially sight lines from their house. Potentially, we don't know.
But
are they hardwood or something?
But it's still some of each.
I just wonder if it was like 10 white
species,
giant white.
No,
ones.
It was, yeah, it was, it was some of each.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, it's. It didn't seem like it was for a sight line because it still ends in trees. It's just a couple of feet deeper. It, you know, I mean, it's kind of, I don't get it. So anyway, so that's one. Another is another abutter further down has created a tractor path where they're taking their tractor onto the Audubon property and out into one of the fields, and then back around. And so they...
Out into the Audubon field?
Yes. They've made a path that they can drive their tractor on.
So like a walking onto. Path that's maintained?
Yes. And there, there are horses on that property as well. So I suspect it's a path that they can, you know, walk with their horses on and get out into the fields.
Are horses allowed on the Audubon property?
Field. No.
Was there any indication that there was horse activity?
No.
We didn't see any hoof.
Yeah, there weren't any conspicuous hoof prints. But we did put up, Phil Brown had brought a couple of signs that said what permitted uses were and non-permitted uses. So we put one of those up.
Right there.
Right there.
The only ones that are
yes.
Did they actually mention horses? I forget about what the sign said, but anyway.
I don't think it did, but it said no wheeled vehicles or, mm-hmm. you know, there was something about motorized vehicles and that. And that, you know, there were tire tracks. There were conspicuous tractor tire tracks. That was really the...
The tracks.
Yeah.
Is it from the...
That's really the violation.
Left or the right if you're on the road?
It's coming off from Tall Pines Road.
Yeah.
So as you're, if you're, if we're standing on 152 looking out, they're coming from the left.
Right.
Or from the western side.
The western
side. Yeah.
How far is it through the woods to access the field? Or is it just, is the field right there?
It's less than 100 feet.
Yeah.
It's, you know, yeah. It's
basically abuts all those.
It's not real far.
The house lots.
Is there a stone wall all the way?
Well, most of the way, yeah. This was one of those areas where there's a little break in the stone wall. You know, it's a 20-foot gap or whatever.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Easy, pretty easy for a tractor to go through. We also found three.
Are we going to write a letter to them? Or
yes, we're going to write a letter to them as well.
So I was wondering what
two,
the agreement
two letters.
Was there. Do we hold, does Audubon own the property and then we own an easement over that?
Yes.
Okay. Then, so, and then we're in charge of monitoring the easement and acting on any
Yeah, acting on any easement violations. And we also found three deer tree stand, or tree stands, presumably deer hunters, on the property, and that was a question that we asked Phil Brown of, you know, does Audubon have a policy on this? And he was unfamiliar. And we need to correspond more to clarify that.
And yeah. One of the stands had obviously cut down some trees, small trees for sighting.
For sight lines, yeah. Which, that's obviously a violation.
You didn't confiscate them? We're going to have like a little conservation commission sale at the end of the year.
They're retreated.
Right before the police conferences, yeah.
We did not, and one of the area, I mean, two of the tree stands were on trees right next to each other. And there was a game camera mounted on a tree right next to it as well. And we're pretty sure we had our picture taken a few times. Because the number changed as we were in the area. Other than that, the property seemed to be in good condition, good repair. And a beautiful property.
But it's not posted no hunting, correct?
Hunting is permitted.
Oh, okay.
Yes, hunting is permitted.
So the question is whether or not you can have a tree stand.
And I think in my mind, the question is more, these tree stands were non-permanent, mm-hmm. which I personally think is appropriate, mm-hmm. and I would hope that they are removed and that there's nothing. At least one of the tree stands had a ladder of sorts that connected to the stand and came down to the ground and was not in any way contacting or harming the tree. And then I think one of the other ones, I think, had some big steps that were screwed into the tree to access the stand. And those I could see as damaging the tree, depending on the size of the tree. And the location and frequency of the steps, blah, blah, blah. So it seems it would be reasonable to have some sort of policy established. So I'm hoping Audubon will establish a policy, and then, you know, we can notify tree stand owners appropriately.
Right.
Well, I believe that tree stands, kind of similar to ice fishing houses, are supposed to have the owner's name and address and contact information on the tree stand. So, let's see, anything else on that list, Stephanie? Oh, they are still, they're working on, if you remember, that property had a former sand pit that was being reclaimed in it. The excavator sort of work in the sand pit, the reclamation part, have been completed. They're still working on some invasive species removal. There's a fair amount of Japanese knotweed right in that immediate area of the sand pit, and they're still working on. They did some treating of that at the end of the summer and into the fall, and then they're going to continue to monitor that and do what they can to remove those invasive species. There's also a fair amount of autumn olive in some of the fields sort of in the middle area. That will do nothing but spread, sadly. We also did see, that's worth noting too, there was a lot of beaver activity on Follett's Brook in that area that we did not see last year. Mm-hmm. For anyone that was with us last year, there was a little metal bridge, a little strip of metal that we walked across, and that was under about at least 6 inches of water because there was a small beaver dam just downstream of it. So we crossed Follett's Brook using a beaver dam because that was the best way to keep our feet from getting too wet. And there was some additional beaver activity upstream of that as well.
Did you see any related bird type activity? Is it just the wrong time?
Yeah, I mean, nothing, you mean wading birds or anything of that sort?
I mean, that's, it's why Audubon has it, right?
Oh.
Because of the bird habitat.
Yeah, I mean, we weren't really looking, I guess I would say. We were pretty much sticking to the...
Hammering.
Sticking to the boundary, yeah. Tacking up the signs. Yeah, yeah. All right, so that's it for Smith Audubon, unless anyone else has anything on that one. Next is Silverman Schneer. That one we need to schedule, and at this point, I would suggest we delay until January on the scheduling of that one. Unless anyone has an objection. It's a busy time of year.
Yeah, we gotta wait till we see if things are gonna freeze.
Right. So warm, yeah. And the same for Wigan Farm. I believe we do have a time limit on Wigan Farm, and I think we need to have a report in by January 30th. So I think on our next agenda, we'll have Wigan Farm, and I'll try and propose a date, which will be somewhat early January to get that one done. All right, that's it on stewardship monitoring. Annual report, I drafted an annual report starting from last year's annual report and sent that out. Got some good suggestions back on that. I have not incorporated those yet, but I hope to do that either, I hope to get it back out by Sunday night. So I'll send out another version with those updates in it. And again, please read, review, and if you have any additional suggestions, send them on. And then I need to get it to Kathy Castle, I believe, by the 19th. That's our date to get that done by. So we've got that well underway. All right. Anything else under new old business?
Yes.
Excellent.
I don't know. We talked this last time. I didn't know if you wanted to go over the action items and just to clarify what we have and still have yet to do. Okay. So I brought them.
Good.
So we have yet to find out about stone wall pillar repairs in Shanda Park and alternative light fixtures. There was talk of following up with a language clarification on the special permit mitigation for 32 Huckins Drive. I didn't know.
I think that was just kind of in the report.
Okay.
Yeah, the issue of mitigation.
Okay. We were trying to source the Overshawn expenditure, which we must postpone. We talked about the sand salt pile near the senior center and pushing snow from boat ramp into the river. I don't know.
No action. I will definitely do that this week.
I don't know if this is like, or whatever. So draft a check request to pay dues.
Yeah, that one still needs to get done too.
Okay.
It's on my list.
Draft report for viscastic Loisel monitoring.
Yeah, that's still on my list too.
Draft annual report for town, check.
Check. Got one done.
Do it, Hawkins.
And then
yeah, okay.
Gather ideas and discuss dogway signage. And
oh, yeah, that was going good.
I have some, in case anyone didn't get the emails, these are examples of what some of the signs or options are. I didn't print them all, but I didn't know.
Okay,
I want to send.
Yeah.
I circled the one that I thought might be the most appropriate, and then I thought we could use our own wording because the wording on the other one didn't seem to talk about ramifications of dog waste in the area. And then so suggested wordings are, there's three options there. I don't know what it is. Dog waste pollutes our drinking water, scoop the poop, or pick it up. I don't know, something like that. And then there was talk about just saying something like dog waste pollutes our water supply. Though I think in the places that drinking water, it actually affects the drinking water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's more powerful to say mm-hmm. drinking water.
Where would that, you're thinking like Piscassic River, Loisel, and then the Piscassic River
Wigan
part, the smaller part.
In Wigan Farm?
Drinking water.
I mean,
it's close to the aquifer.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, one of the reasons
yeah,
that Wigan Farm was supported by outside funders was because the water from Wigan Farm can sink into the aquifer that we draw the well water from. You know, if you think where the two wells are, they're on 152.
Right.
And that aquifer spans a decent distance.
Have they found dog waste in aquifers? Just out of curiosity, is it, have they? In that, that deep of a water?
I don't know if it's been tested there, but I could definitely say that in Dover, they, when they were doing the Dover thing, they did find that 95% of the bacteria was non-human, dog-related associated waste.
Is it surface water or groundwater?
That was in the river, then the river she goes, so.
See, that's what I'm saying, I could definitely see it in surface water, like the water treatment facility that we have, I don't know if it still functions over there, Piscataway River. Because the Piscataway River doesn't meet the EPA.
Right.
So they don't use it.
Or how about the high nitrogen levels in the bay?
That, yeah, definitely. That's what I was thinking of for surface.
The dogs, isn't it?
It is, it's the geese, it's more the geese.
They're an on-point source.
The deer and the rabbits.
Even a pointer?
Hair.
So what's our action? Is it to buy these signs with the suggested wording?
Yes.
Okay. Is that a motion?
There's two, I mentioned, there's two sizes, and I don't know if we want to talk about that. It's one's,
Bigger.
Go for the bigger.
One's four, and four by six and a half, or four and a half by six or something, and then one's.
Nine by twelve.
Nine by twelve.
Which is basically a sheet of paper.
You gotta go bigger.
That's the bigger one, it's a sheet of paper?
That's the bigger one.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, well, this is eight and a half by 11, and the sign's 9 by 12, so.
Okay.
And is that just gonna be on the kiosks? Or at the entrance to a trail, or I don't know, I guess it's up to the people hanging the sign.
Like, do we need posts to purchase in addition to?
We don't need posts.
Okay.
In the worst case, I have a few in my basement that I would love to get out of my basement.
I don't think it in your basement.
What are these signs?
You saw that budget line item for stroller signs.
No pets.
No parking signs.
So.
Well, and Drew suggested that we could order up multiple, a couple different wordings for what's appropriate.
Right, yeah, I mean.
Good idea, yeah.
Right, I mean, to me, if I think about Heron Point, that's not near our drinking water, but it's right near the Lamprey Bay, right, it's right near the Lamprey River and feeds into the water, so that's a water, you know, that's a water quality one, or, you know, gets into the water. Sliding Rock.
Water quality.
Water quality. Wigan Farm, I think I would say drinking water.
Well, they're all water. How about if dog waste pollutes our water and just say that?
Yeah, except that if you can, if it really is close to our drinking water, doesn't dog waste pollutes
your
drinking water? Doesn't that carry a little more weight than dog waste pollutes
point
our water?
Point taken, and
yeah.
I agree. It does give it a little more weight.
So yeah, so where it's appropriate, I like to add that word.
Sure.
So are there any other places where it's appropriate?
I'm not sure. I think the thing to do is
well.
To look at that wonderful map that Stephanie made for us. And then
that's a good idea. Wherever the trails are, just get the appropriate sign for it.
Sign for the appropriate property.
So is that an action for one specific individual? And can we give them the permission to proceed?
I would like to have a motion to buy signs.
So moved.
So, well,
let's.
So, how much
value
are the signs each? I'll put it into a motion.
$10.
There's 17.
Is it a charge?
Yeah.
Including the custom text.
Yes. 17, including the custom text.
So, yeah, this says 10.
So, for simplicity of math, for my small brain, let's just call it 20.
Mm hmm. And we need a potential of how many?
I would say 10.
That's one per property?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I make a motion, because it might have shipping and handling.
It definitely has shipping and handling of approximately $20.
For the order. So I make a motion to expend up to $250 for the purchase of signage relating to removal of dog waste
from town owned
properties on various commission maintained properties.
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Or discussion?
Opposed?
The ayes have it.
250.
Continuing on with that thought, I did look into, I read a little bit about the Dover campaign, and I also looked at some other ways that towns in New Hampshire have tried to promote the awareness of this issue. And I had some ideas that we may, want to think about. So I guess I'll go through them. I guess, one option, we could do a PSA or a slide for Channel 13. That's a public service announcement. And then what they do in Dover is they have a pledge form. When dog owners register their dogs, they have a pledge that says, I pledge not to scoop the poop. And then they collect those pledge forms, and then they put them in a drawing, and then whoever wins the drawing, they actually get a picture, professional photograph of the owner and the pet, which is an interesting idea.
Yeah, get the Dog for Downtown, donate that service.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Thinking.
That's another thing, just maybe, if we didn't want to go that far, maybe just having a flyer that gets handed out whenever someone registers their dog. I don't really know what percentage of dogs get registered, but I do have numbers from 2006, 2007, 2008. It basically ranges between 1,100 and 1,200 dogs that are registered in Newmarket.
Oh, Newmarket.
In Newmarket, in our town.
Wow.
So, I don't know, maybe we could think, I printed out a flyer that maybe we could model in terms of if we wanted to put some information and print X amount of copies and give them to the town, and maybe we could ask them to hand out with dog registration. And then there was another idea that they have another education campaign where at fairs and street happenings, which we have several of in New Hampshire, in Newmarket, they give out dog biscuits with attached information. So that might be another way to spread the word if we were interested. And if we have a kiosk at the Conservation Commission, at the Heritage Festival, it may actually be a way to engage with people too and actually get them to talk to us if we're interested in that. And then one last thing that may be of interest is, if this is a specific problem in a specific area, I get Heron Point had been mentioned several times, we could try to conduct a little bit of an education campaign just there, maybe putting information flyers, or they have door knob attachment information things, just alerting people, just so you know, this is how dog waste affects the water supply, that kind of thing. And then if that's something that we wanted to do, the management campaign recommends that you send out some kind of survey to ask people, what they think of the situation, and then you do the educational thing, and then you survey again to see if it's changed anyone's thoughts. And maybe we don't get to go that far, but I just thought I would put it out there as potential.
One thing that was proposed a while back was a dog park for Newmarket, and we thought it was a good idea. We haven't been able to really secure an area for it, or we've kind of, sent some people out to do good and come back with maybe some suggestions, which they did, but for one reason or another, the properties always seemed like wouldn't make it happen. But I think that might always have been kind of an option in this regard too, but we've yet to find a piece of land that would make it happen. But some of them were actually proposed along the Lamprey, which would have been done by the sewer treatment. That would just make matters worse. So, I'm glad we didn't go with that one.
Gave me a stroke over that one.
Yeah. But I was thinking, what if we had a fax? Like, how some of this information can be kind of startling. If you had just a quick bullet point, put it on our kiosk, maybe some simple things by the dog sign that says, this is what's going to happen if you let your pet waste go into the water or not.
I think something like that, to me, handed out when you get your dog license is
absolutely
more valuable than, I just don't believe in over signage, kind of basically,
yeah,
is my perspective.
I agree too.
I believe in education further beyond.
But some simple startling facts.
Something
maybe
like Something like that, like you mentioned, with the.
The number of dogs.
With the license, when the license, you know, you go in, I get a dog license every year. Hand you that piece of paper, look at it, hopefully you read it.
I like that in the, something for the cable. Just a little slide.
So the portrait's definitely out.
Let's say.
Maybe next year.
Okay. You and Moxie.
Okay, so.
I mean, it is a point, I mean, I wasn't here for the initial discussion last month, but it is a nice, it's nice bringing it up because it does dovetail with the whole non-point nitrogen thing. So we talk about wanting to educate as a way to curtail non-point sources, and this is a good inroad for it.
And I guess my question would be, if we think it's a good idea to have something to hand out with dog registrations, as a dog owner, I know that I received something recently that dog registrations, you know, start in January. So.
Do you register by mail, or do you have to physically come down?
You have to get the tags.
Do you have to get tags?
You have to get the tags, so I think you physically show up, yes.
Or you do it, or.
I know we do, but I, you know, I'm close by, so I'm not sure that I'm necessarily the best example.
So. I don't, or I guess we would have to ask Becky, but I think at least for the purpose of the meeting here, maybe we want to authorize expenditures to provide, you know, the printing cost of that. You know, and have them distributed with every, to every dog owner who's registering.
That's great.
And, you know, and some people might have two dogs, so it's not like we're printing 1,000.
Right. That's a good point.
You know, I'm sure they can just print them in-house and then, depending on the cost is, and then just charge it to the Conservation Commission to the operating account.
How many dogs do you say are licensed?
Around 1,200.
So it's 1,200 sheets of paper roughly?
The latest information was 2008, so I don't actually know if it was licensed.
So a ream of paper or two, I think we can handle that. I don't know how many sheets are in a ream, but.
Well, they'll charge you per copy.
Yeah.
You know, because it's the person making the copy.
Well, yeah, how about this, how about if I contact Becky Benvenuti and we'll, I'll ask. I'll say, first of all, you know, is she willing and or able to do this? And if the answer is yes, then we can ask, okay.
Because if they're just in the office, they're not gonna.
Right.
Exactly.
People aren't gonna take them.
Right.
They like need to physically
be handed
with the license.
I would agree.
Or I thought my license was taped to something the last one I got, like maybe I did, maybe we did it through the mail and it was taped to the piece of paper, like.
Yeah, it could be.
I mean, that's the way they actually have to look at it and pull one piece off. I mean, someone's gonna tape 1,200 dog licenses to paper, might be a little much to ask, but.
But we, I mean, another thing is, when you talk to me, you could say that some of us could help her with that process. You know, a couple evenings, or not evenings, because she's not gonna work evenings, but whatever, afternoons or something, maybe.
Wednesday evening.
Does she work Wednesday evenings?
Because they're generic. The license, the tags are generic. It just says Newmarket Dog License 1.
It's got a number.
2.
Yeah.
So I mean, you could potentially take home 50 of them.
That's true.
Tape them and bring them back the next day. So that, then, I don't know if they care about the order. It'd get difficult, I guess, if they're taped to pieces of paper.
Yeah, we can ask, we can figure all that out. All right, so I'll ask Becky and then we'll figure it out from there. And I would say at this point, I don't think we need a motion for expenditure of funds.
Good.
We can figure that out and we'll.
We spent enough.
We'll do it in January.
So for the wording on the signs, do we want, does whoever will be taking over that action item, do they need more direction or just come up with?
As appropriate, I think it'd be fine. An individual.
I think we're okay.
Okay.
So you'll have the town owner then? Is that the deal?
Yeah, is that the best way to do it? Probably is.
I
Sure. So I'll do some counting, and then we'll send something out that says, you know, this location, this wordage, this location, that wordage, blah, blah, blah.
I apologize if I asked this the last time, but I can't remember. Are all of our properties essentially dog, friendly?
Open to dogs?
Open to dogs?
Except for Shonda.
Except for Shonda, yeah.
Shonda's the exception, and is it well-marked in that regard?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely no dogs, or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, great. Anything else under, new old business? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Excellent. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Guys have it.